welcome to another edition of Mysteries of the Superstition Mountains. And today, we are going to find out everything there is to know about the gold that was found under Jacob Waltz's deathbed. And we're going to do it from a man who shook the hand of the man who shook the hand of the man who was there. You got it? Let's go right now and find out about the gold. Elaborate a little bit on the stories we all have heard about the gold of the Dutchman's under his bed when he died.
Well, at the Dutchman's deathbed, there were only two people present. The Dutchman, when he first moved in with Julia, stayed in a small rental sort of an apartment behind Julia's home. But as his physical condition deteriorated, she moved him into a room in back of her bakery where she could keep close watch on him.
Again, we've heard stories about who was with the Dutchman when he died, so just what are the facts?
And one morning, very early, when she went to work, the Dutchman was failing. So she left to go find a doctor, and as she left on the street, she met two men, Gideon Roberts and Dick Holmes. Now, Gideon Roberts was an intimate friend of the Dutchman. We believe that Gideon Roberts traveled with the Dutchman from Castroville, Texas, to the California gold fields, then up to the Prescott area, and then finally down to Phoenix, where the Roberts homestead was adjacent to the Dutchman's homestead. They were dear friends. Dick Holmes was with Roberts. He was only a casual acquaintance of the Dutchman. But because of his presence with his dear friend Gideon Roberts, the Dutchman simply accepted Dick Holmes as being a reliable person. So Julia asked Roberts and Holmes to sit with the Dutchman while she went for the doctor. Well, she was delayed 2 hours. The doctor was delivering a baby. And by the time she got back, the Dutchman had died. Well, in the 2 hours that Julia was gone, the Dutchman made what we call his deathbed revelation to Holmes and Roberts. Now, there was on the Western frontier, even among unchurched people, the idea that on your deathbed you make what they called your final confession. They called it making your peace. And it was in those 2 hours that the Dutchman told Holmes and Roberts the circumstances of him discovering the mine and trying to direct Dick Holmes back to the mine. He picked Dick Holmes because Gideon Roberts was the Dutchman's age. He was an old man in feeble health himself. In fact, Roberts died just a few months after the Dutchman did, died of silicosis. They called it miner's disease in those days.
How much gold was in the candle box under his bed?
In telling about the mine, he told Dick Holmes, he said, "Under my bed in a miner's candle box is what I have left of the ore out of the mine." He said, "I made 3 caches back there. I didn't trust banks. I made 3 caches of gold back in the mountains, a large cache and 2 small caches. But he said, "I went back later and I packed one of the small caches out. It's what I've been living on all these years." And he said, "What's left in it, of it is in a miner's candle box under my bed." He said, "Dick, get it out." Holmes got it out. It was heavy. The Dutchman told him to open it. And when he did, Holmes could scarcely believe his eyes. There was nearly 50 pounds, 48 and a half pounds, actually, of incredibly high-grade ore in that candle box, richer than anything Holmes had ever dreamed of. And Holmes was somewhat of a prospector. In fact, his father was a graduate of the University at Ann Arbor, Michigan, with a degree in geology and mineralogy. Holmes had some background. Well, the Dutchman tried to direct Holmes back to the mine. The problem was he was not able to use place names because it was only in the Dutchman's later years that they were attaching names to the mountains and the canyons in Superstition Mountain. So he couldn't say LaBarge Canyon, Boulder Canyon, or Peters Canyon. He didn't know the names. He could only describe what the country looked like as he traveled. And in one of the roughest pieces of wilderness terrain on the North American continent, it simply wasn't good enough. They never found the mine. But Holmes sold the gold to Goldman's store. Leo and Charlie Goldman ran a mercantile store on the northeast corner of Central and Washington in Phoenix. And interestingly enough, that store was founded by Miguel Peralta, who operated the Valenciana mine up the Black Canyon country. And there's a legend, it may be the same Miguel Peralta that had mines in the Superstition Mountains back in the 1840s up through the 1860s. Well, that 48 and a half pounds of gold had to have an assay to determine its value for the purchase. They took it to an assayer named Joe Portery, had an assay, little assay shop on Wall Street. The street's not there anymore. It's nothing but an alley today. And Portery took representative samples and assayed that ore at $110,000 a ton when gold was $20.64 an ounce. That would be a couple million dollars a ton in today's gold values. Holmes kept several pieces of the gold that he later had made into jewelry. In fact, some of the gold that Goldman's bought was acquired by a Phoenix jeweler named Rosenzweig that cut a number of the best pieces into jewelry settings. And a jeweler named John Levy in San Francisco acquired some of the ore and made jewelry, including a gold matchbox that later became quite famous. It was the largest piece of jewelry, so the most representative piece of jewelry, most representative of the wealth of the Dutchman's gold.
So Clay, have you seen the Dutchman's gold? I mean, really, and held it in your hand?
And I've seen eight pieces of what we call Dutchman jewelry that still exist here in Arizona. It's all the same stuff. It is all incredibly rich. So that's the story of what happened to the Dutchman's gold.
Okay, concerning the existence of the assay, is there proof that it even existed?
Well, the actual assay is not documented. Now, Joe Portery's records are still in existence, but they're all in French and they've never been translated. They're down at Superstition Mountain Historical Society. The chances of him actually retaining assay records over many years is pretty doubtful, although the possibility still exists that that assay could be a record. But no, there's no actual documentation on this. And you know, some people say, oh, this can't be true because, you know, Dick Holmes wasn't rich. He died the same as everybody else did. And I always ask him, well, where was he buried? Well, I don't know where he was buried. Well, he was buried in a marble crypt in a mausoleum in Phoenix. He wasn't buried in Potter's Field. Holmes evidently was in possession of a substantial amount of money. And he said that's where it came from.
All right, so Clay, did you know Riney Patrash?
No, I didn't know Riney. Riney died. Riney killed himself in Superior in 1943, shortly before I came to Arizona. I came here in 47. But I knew Riney's brother, Herman. Now, where Herman figured into it, when the Dutchman died at Julia's home, Julia and Riney felt that the Dutchman had, even though he had never taken them to the mine, that he'd told them enough about it that they might stand a chance of actually finding it. But neither one of them was qualified to search. But Riney had his brother Herman and his father Gottfried, both experienced miners, that were at that time living near Helena, Montana, probably not right in town. But Riney wrote a letter to his father and his brother outlining some of the story and telling the clues that he knew of to try and convince his brother Herman and his father Gottfried that they really had something to go on, that Gottfried and Herman should come down and organize a search for the mine, which they did. But again, the sketchy part that Riney and Julie had picked up just wasn't good enough. That's big country back there. Terribly rough, big, big country. They never found the mine.
Could he have actually stolen that from some other mine?
Well, you're very right. One of the most popular theories for the source of the Dutchman's gold was that he worked at the Vulture Mine and high-graded, stole rich specimens of gold. And there was extremely rich gold at the Vulture Mine at Wickenburg. Now, I mentioned that the assayer that assayed the gold under the Dutchman's bed was a man named Joe Porterie. Well, when that rumor came out that the gold under the Dutchman's bed came out of the Vulture Mine at Wickenburg, Porterie threw up his hands and said, absolutely not. That there was rich mine in the Vulture, but it was nothing like what was under the Dutchman's bed. And Porterie should have known, because the chief assayer at the Vulture Mine was Joe Porterie. That's all that man did from morning till night was handle Vulture ore. If the Dutchman's ore had been from the Vulture, Porterie would have recognized it immediately. But then regarding Goldfield, I maintain it can't be here because the Dutchman was headed out to Cavanus's, back into the Superstitions. He'd have gone right by Goldfield, which he could have driven up to with a buckboard. But there were samples taken, including this Dutchman matchbox that I mentioned that was made by John Levy and Company in San Francisco. There was the matchbox, samples from the Mammoth Mine here at Goldfield from the Pioneer era, samples from the Black Queen here at Goldfield, samples from the Vulture, samples from the Bulldog here at Goldfield, and these were taken to the Mackey School of Mines up at Reno. And I was present at that time. I helped take this material up there. And it was placed under a scanning electron microscope and very carefully examined. But there are limitations to what you can do with a scanning electron microscope. For one thing, the magnification is so extremely powerful that you examine only a very tiny, minute spot on a specimen. You can't get an overall view of anything. And so what it boiled down to, you can't say that the Dutchman gold came from a specific place. You can say that it was only very similar or very dissimilar to the other specimens that you're examining.
Did that gold match any other known mine?
And under the electron microscope, it was pronounced very dissimilar from any other specimen that we had. The Dutchman matchbox was also one time taken to the Arizona Mines, Department of Mines and Mineral Resources in Phoenix, where it was examined by several very prominent Arizona geologists, mining men, and they all agreed that they knew of nothing similar to that that ever came out of any known Arizona mine, that it must have come from an unknown source. So it's one of the mysteries of Superstition Mountain.
Well, there you have it, firsthand from someone who was there when the gold from under the Dutchman's bed was tested, and they found out that it doesn't match any gold from anywhere else. Just another mystery of the Superstition Mountains.